The Quran claims to affirm the Torah and Gospel, and that its messenger can be found in the earlier scriptures. But the Quran differs from the prior scriptures in important ways, and the Quran's messenger is nowhere to be found in the scriptures of the Jews and the Christians. Beginning with the presupposition that the Quran cannot be wrong, the polemic of biblical corruption has evolved in the Muslim world from something very limited for the early Muslim communities to its present fully developed stage, where millions of Muslims readily affirm the wholesale corruption of the Bible. Given this fact, it's supremely ironic that a very strong case for the enduring preservation of the Torah and Gospel can be made from the Quran itself. Surah 3, 3-4 states that Allah Himself sent down the Torah and Gospel. The Torah is still intact by the time of the Quranic Jesus, who is taught it by Allah, along with the Gospel. The Quranic Jesus further states that He confirms the Torah, which the Quran has supreme respect for. It's not only sent down by Allah and confirmed by the Quranic Jesus, but it's said to contain the judgment of Allah. It's likely that the book that the Quran describes being given to Moses is the Torah. The book was sent down as light and guidance. Surah 1094 indicates that the book can refer to the totality of the earlier scriptures. If you are in doubt about what we have sent down to you, ask those who have been reciting the book before you. It's difficult to imagine Allah telling the messenger that, if he is in doubt, he should consult people reciting something other than what Allah Himself revealed. Likewise, Surah 6:156 seems to point back to the Torah and Gospel, as it mentions the book being sent down for two peoples before the time of the Quran. In context, Surah 5:44 refers to the Torah as the book of God. If Surah 7:144 refers to what was given to Moses as the Torah, which is plausible, then the Torah is referred to as the word of Allah, and nobody can change His words. The Quran also claims to affirm that which was previously sent down and still available at the time of the revelation of the Quran. It does this numerous times in numerous ways. In Surah 350, 546, and 61:6, the Torah specifically is said to be confirmed. The Quran's attitude to the previous revelations is clearly positive. Additionally, some Muslim translators insert Quran into Surah 42:52, taking the Quran, therefore, to be guidance and light. Guidance and light are exactly how the Torah and Gospel are specifically described in Surah 5:44 and 46. In context, Surah 6:157 appears to refer to the Quran, calling it guidance and mercy. The book of Moses is described the same way a couple of verses earlier. Surah 10:94 has already been mentioned. To that we can add Surah 3:93. Both of these verses assume the prior scriptures are intact. Surah 10:94 commands the messenger of the Quran, taken to be Muhammad, to consult those with the prior scriptures if he is in doubt. Surah 3:93 certainly assumes the Torah is a reliable standard by which to judge. Indeed, the Quran presents both the Torah and the Gospel as enduring and reliable. Surah 5:43 places the authority of the Torah over the messenger of the Quran. How will they make you their judge when they have the Torah? Likewise, the Christians are to judge by the Gospel. The Torah and Gospel have priority among the people of the book. Surah 5:68 says, "Say, people of the book, you are standing on nothing until you observe the Torah and the Gospel, and what has been sent down to you from your Lord." Such commands make no sense if the narrator of the Quran believed the prior scriptures were corrupted. Muslims, at this point you've heard a number of verses from the Quran. I'd like you to compare these very positive descriptions of the Jewish and Christian scriptures with the very negative descriptions that you hear in the Muslim world, and ask yourself, why do Muslims so frequently contradict the Quran on this issue? Now let's look at some verses that Muslims frequently say describe corruption of the prior scriptures. Surah 2:79 says, "So woe to those who write the book with their own hands, and then say, 'This is from God,' in order to sell it for a small price. Woe to them for what their hands have written, and woe to them for what they earn. Who are those? The Quran doesn't say. What book? The Quran doesn't say. Yet many Muslims take advantage of such vague verses in the Quran to argue that the Quran is describing the corruption of the prior scriptures, and they do this against the numerous clear statements about the enduring validity of the prior scriptures. But when we look at the early commentaries before the evolution of the now widespread belief in wholesale biblical corruption, we see a different story. For example, on Surah 279, McCottle wrote that the unidentified those in the verse are the chiefs of the Jews of Medina. The Jews erased the description of Islam's messenger from the Torah, according to McCottle, and wrote something other than his description. Keep in mind, by the time we get to the 7th century, the Torah existed over a wide geographical area in many languages. McCottle is simply arguing that a group of Jews in Medina tampered with the Torah to erase Muhammad's description from it. Al-Razi raises a relevant point in this regard. At Surah 378, Al-Razi posed the question, how is the insertion of Tahrif possible in the Torah with its great renown among people? At Surah 446, Al-Razi asked again, how is falsification of text possible in relation to a scripture whose every letter and word was transmitted with the maximum of security in the West as well as in the East? Surah 378 is another example of a vague verse. Surely there is indeed a group of them who twist their tongues with the book, so that you will think it is from the book when it is not from the book. And they say it is from God when it is not from God. They speak lies against God, and they know it. Again, the Quran does not say who they are or what the book that's being twisted is. This verse clearly refers to misinterpretation, twisting with tongues. However, a number of Muslim commentators included accusations of textual falsification in their explanations of this verse. McCottle and Tabari both say this verse refers to the Jews in Medina. Sounds familiar. Al-Zamakhshari limits the action to a specific group of people as well. According to the Jalals, the verse refers to twisting the description of Muhammad, while Ibn Kathir transmits traditions that say the Torah and Gospel are unchanged, even to the letter, and that Allah's books are protected and cannot be changed. In summary, the Quran does not directly state that the Torah or Gospel were corrupted, and any attempts by modern Muslim exegetes to exploit vague Quranic verses to mean the corruption of the Torah and Gospel do so in contradiction to what the Quran clearly states about the enduring validity of the prior scriptures. Gordon Nickel comments, it is impossible to support the Muslim accusation of the corruption of the Bible with verses from the Quran that actually name the earlier scriptures. Mahmoud Ayyub states, contrary to the general Islamic view, the Quran does not accuse Jews and Christians of altering the text of their scriptures, but rather of altering the truth which those scriptures contain. The people do this by concealing some of the sacred texts, by misapplying their precepts, or by altering words from their right position. However, this refers more to interpretation than to actual addition or deletion of words from the sacred books. Muslims should ask themselves why the corruption of the Bible is such a widespread belief in the Islamic world, when that belief contradicts the Quran, the book that Muslims claim is their supreme authority. For more about the evolution of the biblical corruption polemic in the Muslim world, see this video. If you'd like to look at the verses I cited more thoroughly, remember to check out the text version of this video in the free resource in the pinned comment. Thanks for watching.